The philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau believed that babies were born perfect idiots, knowing nothing. William James, who wrote the seminal book, The Principles of Psychology, described babies as living in a blooming, buzzing confusion. And then there was Jean Piaget, known to many in psychology as the father of cognitive development, who described young children, including his own, as curious but lacking essential cognitive capacities. According to Piaget, babies lived in a sensory motor present. Objects they could no longer see or touch no longer existed in their minds. Out of sight was out of mind, which, if true, is sure to disappoint any new parent who isn't perpetually in their baby's line of sight. But it could be part of what makes peekaboo so much fun for babies. The view of young children as naive, unknowing, and even irrational dominated much of psychological science for most of its history. Post-Piaget, however, the field of developmental psychology has benefited from the breakthrough insight that babies' spontaneous looking patterns can tell us more about what they know than trying to get them to do complex things like reach for different objects, which they may have difficulty doing because of their poor motor skills, or to respond to language, which they may not yet have. In my lab, we've leveraged the approach of analyzing babies' looking behaviors to get inside their minds. In these studies, we've examined different types of looking behaviors, such as when babies blink, how long they stare, or where they look, to help us understand what they know about the physical and social worlds. The physical world is comprised of all sorts of objects, and during the first year of life, babies spend much of their time learning about the objects in their environment. They'll come to recognize many of these objects, particularly their favorites. They may even come to predict what the objects are for or how they might work. A question we've asked in my lab is whether babies also know that objects looming towards them may pose a threat. After all, something on a collision course with the body can cause serious harm. Not surprisingly, many of us regard looming objects as dangerous and we respond defensively. We blink to protect our eyes, we may flinch or swerve, or even scream. Do babies show similar reactions? Or are they oblivious to the dangers of looming objects? Here I'll show you a video of a baby in my lab who's watching a computer monitor with a virtual animal looming towards her. It begins with her attentive to this object, and then she blinks just as the object is about to make contact with her, were it a real object moving through space. Of course, that wasn't a real object moving through space, and yet the simulated experience is enough to tell her brain that her eyes needed protecting. And it wasn't just her. Across many babies, we've used this virtual scenario to test whether and with how much precision babies react to objects that appear to be on a collision course with their bodies. Consistently, we find that the amount of babies' blinking behaviors increases at the predicted time to contact, not after, not before, when the object is about to make contact. And this doesn't happen if objects move away from babies or from side to side. So it seems that babies know when moving objects may be dangerous, and we see the beginnings of our defensive reactions to them. In other studies, we've examined how long babies look at different objects to determine how they categorize them. When I see each of these objects, I know they're all cats. I have a category of cat in my mind. As adults, we use categories all the time to help us identify objects we've never seen before and to make predictions about how the objects might function. Typically, objects within a category behave in very similar ways. So even though I've never met this hairless guy on the right, I know what to expect. He's a cat like the others, and so he'll likely meow when he wants food and purr when I pet him. Now, it turns out that the categories we form depend not on information like the cat's markings, their color, or even how fluffy they are. These cats have none of that in common. Instead, it turns out that the categories we form depend on the shape of the objects that comprise those categories, or more specifically, what we refer to as the shape skeleton that captures the spatial relations of the object parts, but leaves out information about the external features like markings, color, or fluffiness. Do babies use a similar shape strategy when categorizing objects? To answer this question, we created a set of novel objects designed to vary in their shape skeletons, external features, or both. As an example of one of the objects we've used in this work, you can see one of them, which some adults like to call pie. And here are two others. The one on the left has the same shape skeleton as the one on top. The one on the right has the same external features. Here's a question for all of you. Which of the two on the bottom belongs to the same category as the one on top? I suspect that many of you thought, and in fact I heard answer, that the one on the left with the matching shape skeleton belongs to the same category. And indeed, I suspect that many of you would be happy to call both of those objects pie. What about babies? When they encounter a novel object, do they expect it to belong to a larger class of objects with the same shape skeleton? And if so, how much experience does it take? Do babies need to see multiple examples of different objects from within the category? Or do they infer category membership from just a single example? To answer these questions, we first presented babies with a novel object, and we measured how long they looked at a video of the object. When we presented them with this same object a few times, they looked at it less and less. This decrease in looking time indicates that they've grown bored with the object that they've seen over and over again. In developmental psychology, we call this process of getting bored habituation. Once babies were habituated, we presented them with two new objects, and again, we measured their looking times. One of the objects had the same shape skeleton as the one they previously habituated to. The other had a different shape skeleton. Now, if babies think that one or both of these objects belongs to the same category as the previous one they habituated to, they'll likely remain bored, and their looking times won't change much. However, an object from a different category is much more interesting. It will re-engage attention and lead to an increase in looking times. We call this dishabituation. When we measured babies' looking behaviors, we found that whereas they dishabituated to the object with the different shape skeleton, they looked at the objects with the same shape skeleton for comparable amounts of time. These results suggest that babies categorize the objects according to their shape skeletons. In other words, they categorize objects, novel objects, much as you and I would. But what's especially impressive about what babies did here is that they formed categories similar to those of adults, despite not having language, such as the word pie, and despite having very little experience in the physical environment. Many of the babies in this study weren't even crawling yet. So it seems that from early in life, when babies encounter novel objects, not only do they remember them, but they make inferences about what other objects from the same category should look like. It's a strategy that will serve them very well as they continue to encounter and learn about lots of other novel objects in their environment. Now, everything I've told you about so far pertains to the physical world. What about the social world? After all, we don't just interact with inanimate objects. We also interact with people, lots of them. A common feature of social groups is that they're hierarchically organized according to dominance. All over the world, and even among some non-human animals, some individuals are more dominant than others. These individuals will wield more power, have access to more resources, and they may even confer more respect or fear from others. Given this structure, it makes good sense to track the dominance relationships within a social group. But it's not always easy, because we only ever have access to a limited set of data. In other words, we don't witness all possible interactions between people. Yet, if babies are to learn about the social world, then they too must make inferences from limited data. Do they? A few years ago, we set out to answer this question in another study where we measured babies' looking behaviors. In this study, we presented babies with a group of puppets, each of which appeared to want an interesting toy. The puppets didn't like to share, however. Here's a video of a baby watching this puppet show with the interactions between the puppets that, as I said, don't like to share. It may not be Oscar-worthy, but it's very entertaining to babies. So all of the babies in this study watched this initial scenario with the two relevant exchanges. In the first exchange, the bear dominated the elephant. In the second exchange, the hippo dominated the bear. What the babies never saw in this initial scenario was an interaction between the hippo and the elephant. This is important because it allowed us to subsequently test whether babies nevertheless infer that the hippo should be more dominant than the elephant, given their shared interactions with the bear. Now, the way we tested whether babies made this inference was we then presented them with two new scenarios. In one scenario, the hippo dominated the elephant, as you might expect. In the other scenario, the elephant dominated the hippo, likely not what you'd expect. The prediction we made about how babies would respond to these scenarios was based on how people typically react to expected and unexpected events. When something expected happens, it's relatively boring, it doesn't elicit much of an interaction or a response. And if you're a baby, there isn't much staring. However, when something unexpected happens, that's much more interesting. It tends to re-engage attention. If you're an adult, it may elicit a surprise reaction. If you're a baby, this usually means a lot more staring. So now I'll show you a video of that same baby about to watch the unexpected event. And you'll notice that we flipped the positions of the hippo and the elephant just to make sure that babies were really attending and responding to the interaction between those two puppets and not something else about where the actions tend to occur. So again, this is the video of the baby watching the unexpected event. Let's see how he reacts. So far, so good. Uh-oh. Pretty interesting. This is really worth staring at. And he stares for quite a while, even after the exchange has ended and there's just a freeze frame. Okay, now he's done with it. In this study, we found that on average, babies looked at the unexpected event for over 11 seconds, and at the expected event for only 6 seconds, a statistically significant difference. So it seems that when babies are learning about the social world, not only do they remember the interactions they've previously witnessed, but they're going on to make predictions about other relationships based on the hierarchy of the group. Babies live in complex worlds, and understanding what they know about these complexities poses serious challenges because they lack the language to tell us what they know, and they're limited in the actions they can perform. Yet by studying their looking behaviors, which they readily perform, my lab and those of other developmental psychologists have made significant strides in getting inside their minds. Far from being naive, unknowing, and even irrational, babies attend to objects and people, remember them, and they go on to make predictions about objects and people based on their limited experiences. There will be a lot more to learn about the world, but babies are starting life with impressive cognitive capacities. The central goal of psychology is to understand human nature, our behaviors, our emotions, and our thoughts. As adults, there's not much we can't do, feel, or think. Understanding the vastness of these capacities requires that we study not only adult minds, but baby minds. Because it's only by knowing where it begins that we can truly know how it may prosper. Thank you.